For the very first time, the Blanc Prince Sprint Series heads to the Hungaro Ring. On this twisty track near Budapest, it's going to be hot, and it's sure to be close. Last time out at the Nürburgring, Rob Bell got away so quickly in the McLaren, there were suggestions he jumped the start. The stewards said no. In hot pursuit, the number 28 Audi, the former GP racer Will Stevens, and Audi factory hot shoe Rennie Rast. The McLaren was away, others went wide. But fortunately, didn't contact each other, but it was jolly close. Meanwhile, rushing up through the field, Bert Schneider in the Mercedes-Benz. They started in 24th. Another car to watch for was the 333 Ferrari. There it is, the Rinaldi car of Norbert Seidler and Marco Seyfried. Great action between the two Audis. But look at that, while they squabble, the Ferrari sneaks by, up into a magnificent fifth place. One car goes wide, a vital pit stop, the 28 car in second place. Can it sneak out in front of the McLaren? Now with Parent at the wheel, but no, it doesn't. Meanwhile, the 19 Lamborghini of Beretta and Stoltz leads the Silver Cup. The 333 Ferrari was still in fifth place, closing stages of the race now. And still, the Audi hunting down the leading McLaren. The checkered flag, the McLaren wins. Bell and Parenti lead the series. They win the race by just 2 seconds. So we head to the Hungaroring race. A great promotion, the cars heading on the public roads for a major meet the public event. And the crowds turned out in their thousands to get up close and personal with the drivers and look at the cars. After this terrific promotion, some of the fans will have their special favourites for the racing. Top German squad Phoenix Racing is down to just one Audi R8 LMS this weekend after an incident eliminated the number 6 car in practice. So holding the fort in the number 5 car would be the Belgian Alessio Piccarello, a 22-year-old hot shoe from the Formula Masters Series, who joins Nicky Moller-Madsen, who is happy with his new co-driver.
Yeah, we have to win the Silver Cup, that's for sure. I got a new teammate this weekend, and I'm really looking forward to race with him. I know him from the past in karting, and I know he's a good driver, and I know we can win the Silver Cup, so that's for sure the goal. He's a little bit better, and hopefully with the new tyres to do the quality. And yeah, I will do the start on Sunday, a bit more experience in the rolling starts, and yeah, together I think we'll be a good mix.
The Hungaroring track has a long history as a Formula One circuit, but a winter resurfacing has changed its character. Bentley, like Audi, tested here, and that has helped the British cars find speed. In the number 7 car is Stephen Kane and Vincent Abril. And in the number 8 Continental GT, Maxime Soule and Andy Suchet. We caught up with Andy about his thoughts of Spa and the upcoming race.
Is over now. Obviously it was tough not to win that one. We were leading for most part of the race, but Budapest is a completely different track. It's a different championship. We are now in the sprint series and short races, 1 hour races. I've got Maxime as a teammate. We know he's very quick as well, so hopefully we can have a good result and get some points for the championship.
Lamborghini has certainly done an outstanding job developing the Huracan into an effective GT3 machine. The GRT Grasser team from Austria are running two of the unmissable lime green supercars. The 19 car leads the Silver Cup. The 16 car has a new driver this weekend in Marco Mapelli. But Stefan Rossina continues in the car.
Yeah, sure, I mean, I am confident, but I think all the other drivers have also plenty of experience, so we did a test here. So let's see. I mean, it's difficult to say. I don't really want to be saying up front that I brought something really special and we're going to win, you know. This is obviously the goal, but this has been the goal since the whole season, and so far we are not able really to put it to the result, so we hope that here is going to be better.
The driver lineup has also changed at reigning endurance champions Nissan, while Ricardo Sanchez from Mexico and UK Sean Walkinshaw pedal the number 22, Alex Buncombe will be joined in the number 23 by the first ever GT Academy winner Lucas Ordóñez. Lucas doesn't know this track well, maybe he's tried it on a PlayStation.
Feeling excited about a new track for us here in Hungaroring. For Alex and me it's a brand new track, so excited to be here. It's not the best track for the GTR for sure. We like high speed corners, we like high speed tracks. Hungaroring is pretty slow, But we will see what we can do. We will try our best, and yeah, we're working hard to have a good car for the weekend.
The Garage 59 McLaren team are desperate to bounce back from the disappointment of Spa 24s. The regular driver pairings of Martin Ploman and Tom Lediger and Alvaro Parenti and Rob Bell. They defend the team's lead in the Blancpain GT team's title race. Meanwhile, Bell heads the GT driver's table and with Alvaro leads the sprint standings. The pair, of course, dominated the last sprint race at the Nürburgring. Rob Bell says they're just taking it race by race.
I think it's just another stepping stone, to be honest. We're here to win the race, and then we'll try and win the other remaining races as well. So we haven't got the mindset of, oh, let's just play it safe and make sure we keep the lead. We're just here to win races, and it's great to be at another fantastic venue. The weather looks fantastic, so we'll just do our best for Garage 59 and McLaren, and hopefully we'll come out on top.
The French-run Mercedes team of Jérôme Polycan runs three cars this weekend. Two of them, the 87 and 89, are in the Pro-Am class, with a lineup which includes the veteran French Jean-Philippe Velot, a hero at this year's Le Mans. But success here in Hungary will most likely come from the 88 car of two drivers who have tasted success on the oval tracks of America. They are Christian Vautier of France and the Swede Felix Rosenqvist.
First of all, I love this city. I've been here quite a lot of times with Formula 3. And I had some testing here in recent years. So yeah, it's a track I'm familiar with. And yeah, having that result from Spa, I think we have to look forward for this week. And yeah, we have a great momentum right now. And yeah, let's see where we are.
The Row Racing team is still on a high after winning the Spa 24 hours. However, the 99 Spa winning car has been retired to the BMW Museum. So it's a brand new machine for Alexandre Sims and his Spa winning co-driver, Philip Eng. Philip knows his way around this track from Porsche's Super Cup campaigns, but still has plenty on his mind.
The second sector is really nice with all these floating corners. It will be third gear, so not slow, but not very fast. And it's really important to position the car well all the time there. It's very technical, but really cool. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, that's the setup. Coming up, the qualifying race. Hello, everyone. I'm Andrew Marriott. Alongside me, John Watson. And it has been a blisteringly hot day here. They're the fans in the grandstand. They've enjoyed the sunshine. I'm not sure it's going to be quite the same, John, for the teams.
No, it's not. It's going to be a very difficult 1 hour here at the Hungaroring, but there are the championship positions.
And as you heard in the earlier piece, Rob Bell leads, and then it's Maximilian Bucht and Dominic Baumann in that Mercedes second, Sule and Suchek, I should say, in third place, and the Bentley Eng and Sims follow them. But McLaren, they seem to have been struggling. In fact, both British teams struggling, John. Look at that. Look at the temperature there. Track temperature, 37.6.
So the ambient 34.1, so it has just, the heat has risen over the course of the day. Yet again, as we saw in qualifying, those that might have seen qualifying earlier in the day, cars going out on a racetrack following other support events here, different rubber going down, a brand new surface, as we've mentioned in the lead up to the head of the show. Everything is, well, it's unknown. We've seen qualifying, but those are short runs in and out of the pit. Now we've got this 1 hour race, the mandatory pit stop coming between 25 and 35 minutes where a driver change and a tire change will take place. And literally, whether you're in the front row of the grid or you're in the middle or the tail, nobody really knows what's going to happen when the checkered flag comes out.
Now we're calling this the qualifying race, John, but it is important. There are points on the board for it and of course grid positions too. There we go to the back of the field. And a total of 34 cars will start today, and they are representing many of the great motor manufacturers of the world. Only one really is missing, Porsche. Not quite sure why. That's a bit of a surprise, but we've got the Mercedes, we've got Audi, we've got Lamborghini, and the 85 car of Schmidt and Jaffar will start from the pit lane. A lot of people running towards that. Not quite sure what the problem is. But that's the last thing you need at the start of a race.
Well, that's a disappointment for the 85 car because to start down the pit lane, they've got to wait until the entire field goes past pit lane exit, before that car can then get into the event. So already a setback for Jasmine Jaffar, and hopefully we might be able to just find out quickly if this race under the formation lap what the problem is. Nevertheless, that car will have to wait until the entire field completes this pace lap behind the safety car. A lot of drivers were saying to me before they went into the event that they will try and go as slowly as is reasonable. They've got to keep a delta speed, but they're not going to put any big load into the tyres because one of the problems is heat. Tyre temperatures go up with the tyre pressures go up with heat, and then as the pressure goes up, the tyre casing, you get a certain amount of crowning on the tread of the tyre, and then ultimately then you lose, particularly at the rear, you lose the traction. So some drivers really being cautious on this period lap.
Yeah, pole position, of course, Christian Vautier and Felix Rosenquist, and they will start on the pole in the Mercedes alongside Enzo Eden, Christopher Mies in the WRT car. More WRT cars on the second row and more Mercedes, Bauman and Bucht and Van Thor and Vavish. Then it's Haas and Parisi again, more Audis. And then the next of the Mercedes-Benz, Salacquada and Stippler and Robin Frins and the younger of the Van Thors, and then the first of the non-German cars. Well, it's got a German engine, Bortolotti and the Lamborghini. More Audis, look, that row. Stockinho will start that car. Then the first of the Bentleys in 13th place, and the first of the BMWs, Katzberg in that one. Belloc and Bure and Meadows and Leonard. Next row, Mapelli, he's a new boy in this championship. Rosina, Jimenez and Baptista. Buncombe and Ordonez in the Nissan, which has probably got some brake problems, we think. Parenti and Bell, the championship leaders, right down there in 21st place. And then Eng and Sims, Stephen and Rast, they're a long way down, John. I wonder if they can stage a bit of a fight through. Schmidt and Jaffar, the car we just seen in the pit lane there, was going to start in 25. It'll now start at the back. Lettergaard and Plowman in the second of the two McLarens, way down there, 28th. And then going towards the back of the grid, Retzer and Stott. The two Dutchmen in their Lamborghini start 31st. Peril and the American entrepreneur, Steve Earle, and Walkinshaw in the second of the Nissan. So that quickly as the 34 cars will start in the heat of the late afternoon here, as everybody just gets stretching. And we're on board the formation lap there briefly. On board with the 99 car and the Row Racing BMW. We'll have five or six different onboards with you, and the pace car is already in, and they'll be blasting into that first corner. Slowly, slowly, waiting. The Mercedes just got a bit of a no start, I think, there, and off they go. And down and on the throttle pedal to the metal, down to that first corner. Already we've got a Ferrari diving through on the inside of the pit lane, right against the pit wall, but no. It's Vautier in the lead. Man who's been racing in the States, IndyCar events, racing for Mans. Oh, and a spinner, look at that! Straight into our sun, and there's quite a few cars off in that incident, John.
Yeah, it's the sound of Lockman, Monty and Edward Tansrom. That got tagged by the Lamborghini there. Further back, you can see one of the Ferraris and further contact as they won or won the attempt to Lamborghini. That was the Zampieri and Niederhauser car. So already contact in turn one and the exit of turn one.
McLaren, I think, just going off wide there. So lots of actions we suspected, and lots of smoke coming from the back of one car. I suspect that's from a tyre problem.
Yeah, I think that's the Ferrari just somewhere got tagged somewhere in that incident in turn one. So everybody's gotten through the first three turns, but there is a 25 Audi. That now is beached, and it's probably its race already over.
That's Monty, Roman Monty.
But, and one of the Audis just cutting across the inside of turn five. That's something that everybody's got to be aware of. Track limits are being very strictly adhered to here this weekend, so any infringement will get a notice to the team. If you do it three times, you will get a drive-through penalty.
That's going to cost you 20 seconds or so.
At least, but you know, everything's so frantic in this opening lap. People are trying to make up positions on the opening lap. Sometimes drivers are a bit cautious on the opening lap, others are more aggressive and try and take advantage of that. Let this settle down at the end of lap one, but what is clear is that 88 Mercedes-Benz and Christian Vautier didn't jump the stop. It had a very good start and was able to consolidate by almost a second from Christopher Mies in the Audi in second place, Dominic Baum in third, Lawrence Van Voor fifth, fourth and Christopher Hasse in fifth, and then the sixth place Mercedes of Jules Kvyat. Full course yellow.
Full course yellow, FCY. and that's presumably to remove a car. But John, I just want to check one thing with you. Are we sure that Vaultier is in the car? Because our timing and scoring is saying it's Rosenqvist.
Yeah, I mean, it should have been, according to everything we were given, it should have been Vaultier, but it is giving timing. The transponders in these cars are the things that should give us the indications as to which driver. So we believe it was Tristan Vaultier, but timing and scoring in the booth is showing that it is Felix Rosenqvist. So,
and again, you thought that Enzo Eid was going to start the 33, but looking at the fact that Christopher Mies is shown on the timing screen and the fact he's hung on to second place, I mean, Enzo's it's not a slow coach by any manner of means, but Christian Mies is probably in a bit of a different level of his career at the moment, being a full-time racer, where Enzo also holds a full-time job. So I think it's probably Mies in that one, and then Bauman. I think we're going to trust the official classification. Yeah, they've gone full course.
Yeah,
yellow, just to remove that Audi. He's in a bit of a dangerous position. Let's see the start again.
So the Mercedes is up and gone, and then it's the battle of like three Audis all trying to get down the inside into turn one, four abreast as they come down pit straight, the Ferrari getting a real flyer, and then everybody fanning into the inside of the circuit behind the lead Mercedes-Benz coming down, then going from right back to left, again three abreast, the Mercedes, the 84 Mercedes, right sort of the meat in the sandwich, but there you can see the 25 Audi. And where does that center lock? Well, that happens much earlier. One of the Ferraris as well. That was at the back of the grid, the 101 Lamborghini. That was the Zampieri and Niederhauser car. That was much further back. But there, the 25 Audi gets spun round. And the contact with that car has meant the full course yellow has been implemented. And it's going to take a minute or two until that particular Audi has been removed safely. And obviously, there's damage to the car that we can't see fully. So they've decided that the best way to do it is just to drag that car and get it behind the barrier as quickly as possible.
John, a lot of Audis up at the front in this particular race. It seems to suit them a lot, this circuit. There's the Row Racing squad, Alexander Sims there sitting with the glasses on.
Yeah, I mean, it's a circuit, the nature of the racetrack, I always felt was going to favour what I would call a mid-engine car layout, which is fundamentally that of the Audi, the McLaren, but McLaren have got other reasons why they're not quick, and I'll get into that a bit later. The Mercedes-Benz, which is ostensibly what you might call front-engine GT, but actually the engine is so far back.
Yeah.
It's a mid-engine, front-engine GT car. And, I mean, it's taking the whole concept of where GT engines in the front, likewise with the new BMW M6, there you can see damage to the... And that's heavy damage to the front of the Lamborghini in the 19 car, so that's going to have a problem. It may not even be able to continue. And that's Michele Barretta, Lucas Stoll's car. So I always felt that this was going to be a circuit, and of course the Audi team have tested here, as have a number of other teams, so they've got that track knowledge, and they fundamentally were starting from a very strong position throughout the period of practice.
So there's our Audi driver walking back disconsolately. His day is done. He'll get to fight another day tomorrow, of course. And Bentley down in 23rd place, I see. But Mercedes, Audi, Mercedes, Audi, Mercedes, Audi, that's the top six. Lamborghini ninth. BMW, the 98 car, up in 11th place. And the first of the Bentleys, the number seven car, is in 13th position. McLaren in 20th.
So they just come round and the clock continues to tick away. So we've already got sort of almost 6 minutes of this race underway, but only in effect, one lap of it has been a racing lap.
Yeah, the incident between the 25 car and the 101, which we saw, that's been put under investigation. And 58 car under investigation as well. And that's the Garage 59. Now we go on board with the Nissan RJN. That's Bob Neville, who runs that team. Had a nice chat with him yesterday. And
That car currently in 18th. So it's pretty much in the heart of the pack of the field. Now there you get a quick glimpse of the McLaren, the 58 car. And the problem that McLaren have had here is, along with everybody else, there's a movable feast when it comes to balance of performance. And it's basically structured on four different categories of circuit. And Stephen Kane and Maxime Soulet laying back and enjoying, well, maybe not enjoying it, waiting to see this race get underway. As the Lamborghini now being craned away. But to go back to the performance of the McLaren, the Garage 59 cars, it's to do with they've had a little bit of horsepower taken away.
Lamborghinis are meant to be lime green, but that one's blue, and it's the machine that's hauling it away, which is lime green.
Yes, so that's the attempt to car, the 101 car.
Yeah.
which the irony is that the removal vehicle is the colour of the grass of racing Lamborghinis. Yeah. But anyway, McLaren have had a weight penalty, as has Audi, as has Mercedes-Benz. Yeah. But along with the weight penalty, they got a little bit of horsepower taken away. And it's that they feel the combination of those two BOP adjustments are the reason why they're not so competitive here. And the way that they categorise circuits as A, B, C and D, and apparently Hungaroring is a Category C circuit, interestingly, so is Silverstone. I don't know what the parallel is between the two, but it's probably this part of the circuit here where the corners flow and technically they are quickish corners. So we're going to have a race
track in 10 seconds.
Okay.
Restart on short notice.
That's our race director.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Green flag.
Look at the gap. Look at the gap. And whether that is something that will be looked at as well, because the lead car had about a 2.5 or 3 second advantage over the second pacer, Christopher Meese. Well, Meese was asleep.
I think he was asleep, to be honest. But anyway, he'll make up for that, I'm sure. But Felix Rosenqvist, little Felix, the reigning Formula 3 champion, loving his switch into sports cars here in the Mercedes team run by Jerome Polycant.
And in the process, Laurens van Forest got ahead of the 84 Mercedes. Yeah. So he's up to third place again. That's being astute once the race director says we are racing, go. You've got to be on your toes, and that's what Laurens van Thor has done. He's put himself up into third place, having a look at Christopher Meese coming down into turn two to try and slot it up into second place. He had to back out of it, otherwise that would have been a collision. So Laurens van Thor, very racy indeed in these, what is now a restart to the race. But look at the gap. Look, where's the field? There it is.
So we've had that full course caution. Everybody's got to get that racing head back on now and really get into it, because this is a sprint race. John, I mean, we're already 17 minutes in, you know, and they've only just started racing. They haven't really got at it yet.
No, I mean, the opening lap was just sort of everybody calming down again. No contact. Oh. Two Audis.
Another Audi going off there.
Yeah, one of them, I'm not sure which one that was, but I think it might have been one of the ISR cars tagged the back. And now everybody's gone across the inside of the curve for whatever reason they're choosing to do that. So again, contact, unnecessary contact, I have to say, down at turn 5. But that is, again, a function or a feature of this Hungaroring circuit. It is very tight, and everybody's going to be closely bunched together. Out of turn 11 now, there's a short, straight run down into a heavy braking into turn 12. You can pass if you're alongside, but it's getting alongside that's the tricky bit.
Previous lap, Meese, fastest of all on the second sector. In fact, it's this very lap, and Meese is putting down a quick one because he's got to close the gap down on Rosenqvist. Rosenqvist, 3.3 seconds in the lead at the moment. That is the number one car with Van Thor, the older of the two Van Thor brothers, doing a great job out there. But look at the Bentley trying to muscle its way through, trying to get past that Audi.
What he did, he actually backed out of it quite early and tried to get better track position to get a run on the number five Audi, but he didn't succeed in doing that. And this is, again, because the qualification here has been so close, the racing is going to be inevitably so close. And when you get a group of cars essentially got the outside of the lead car, which is 3.3 seconds down the road, everybody else is covered by tenths of seconds. So nobody can really build up that momentum, and therefore the opportunities that you might try to create for yourself. As we look at the 23 Nissan getting, well, that's the best we've seen Alex Buncombe look all weekend in the Nissan. Suddenly it's found some pace, but he did say that after 3 or 4 laps he was fearful that the rear tyre pressures are going to go up, and consequently he was going to start to lose grip. But right now, Alex Buncombe pushing very hard in that Nissan in 16th place.
And just a bit of housekeeping, John, because the 58 car, the McLaren, which leads the championship, the Rob Bell car, that has been told to give back a position, so he must have made a position, maybe as a yellow flag came out or something like that.
There were certainly, I mean, that he's going to give it back to the sister car, actually, ironically. So obviously there was some bit of shuffling that went on, and the 58 car, Valero Parente, will have to give that back to the sister car. Yeah. At least it's in the family.
They're lying in 19th and 20th places. It's not where they want to be. Rosenqvist putting down a really quick one, fastest lap of the race thus far. 144.121 from the little Swede. And took 0.4 of a second off Meese. So he's pulling away a little bit here. Great drive by this French-run Mercedes-Benz. And it's so far Swedish driver in it. The French driver will get into it later. There's the 55 Ferrari. That's the one I think that made the cracking start down the inside. And that's in the Am Cup, actually, with Reno Mastronardi.
Yeah, it's Mastronardi behind the wheel, and that's just a strong performance from the car. But the pressure you can see being put now on the Nissan, as that's a further battle further down the field. But back up at the front, 3.8 seconds, the advantage that Felix Rosenquist has managed to eke out. As we go on to the sixth lap, Laurens van Thor, third place in the Audi. He has now managed to put fastest first sector time together. So there is a response from the two Audis running second and third. Laurens van Thor, 8 tenths of a second behind the sister car of Christopher Mies.
John, just for the non-regulars who are watching this great action here, we've got to have a pit stop. Just explain what's happened. They do change the tyres, don't they?
Yeah, 4 tyres on driver change. That'll come after another 25 minutes into the race, or at the latest 35 minutes. So you've got a 10-minute window to decide when you want to bring your car driver pack partnership in, conduct that change, get back out again.
And you have to change the driver.
Change the driver. So the strategy is something that out of the hands of the driver directly, but the driver has input into it. As we see, now watch Rosenquist as he comes out of, he's got clear air, he can use the racetrack to his particular requirements and needs. Goes across the start-finish line, it was 3.7 seconds the last time. It's dropped, actually, Sir Christopher Mies on that last lap has set the fastest race lap and taken out four-tenths of a second. So Audi are coming back, and that's particularly the case of the 33 Audi, Christopher Mies. Laurens van Thor drops back marginally, but responds by going quickest in the first sector. So there's a battle within the Audi family. In the meantime, the Mercedes has still got that comfortable 3.3 second, but they need to be aware that Audi are moving forward. And again, going back to the question you asked me at the beginning of the top of the show, did this circuit favour Audi? My feeling is possibly more than anybody else, but it's a matter of controlling your car, but setting the tyre and not abusing the tyre.
We expected something from Rennie Rast to come up through the field, John, but he's not in the top 20 yet. They must be struggling a little bit, I think. I don't quite know why. So we'll keep monitoring that situation, though, in the number 28 machine.
Yeah, that car is difficult starting so far back. I mean, you've just got to be patient, and you can see what happens if you're impatient. We saw those incidents on the opening lap. We've seen subsequent incidents.
It's Stevens in the car at the moment, and he's in 21st place. But remember, in the previous round at the Nürburgring, they were a very close second at the end.
Yeah, but the benefit was that they started much, much nearer to the front. So their pace, their natural pace, is they're not been able to access that. So they're just going to have to play a long game and wait and see whether they can, as this race gets into the pit stops. And one of the strengths of the WRT team is that they're exceptionally good at pit stops. So that's where they may try and leapfrog some of the cars around them. And then hopefully, as you get into the second part of the race, depending whether you stop before half distance, and a little look down the inside of the Ferrari trying to get past the 4 Audi. That was a fairly brave manoeuvre. The number 8 Ferrari was trying to, that was Andre Petty, the Ferrari trying to have a look down the inside, but not being able to get through.
There you see, scrolling down on the left-hand side of your screen, the top 20 there. Rosenquist leading from Mies and van Thor. Mercedes, Audi, Audi, Mercedes. And then Mercedes, Audi, Audi. Two major German manufacturers right in the middle of this series with very serious programmes indeed.
So second place, Christopher Mies. Third place, Laurens van Thor. Everybody being a lot more respectful, just watching cars coming through turn four in this qualifying race. Not the kind of, what you might say, abuse of the curbs that we saw through Friday practice, and to some degree we saw, in fact, through qualifying earlier in the morning. So people have now finally got the message that miss or abuse of track limits, the penalty is a drive-through if you do it more than twice. The third time is a drive-through penalty, and that penalty will take you out of any... Oh, and again, somebody just cut through. It was one of the Acker Mercedes. Sort of probably felt he was getting a big oversteer, just decided to shortcut the corner. No significant advantage taken as the battered and bashed Lamborghini is sort of beginning to disintegrate by the lap.
Now, this happened a lap ago. Look at the Bentley trying to get down the inside there. Does it make it stick? Yes, he does. Nice move by the 8 car, bouncing it off the kerb, and it worked.
Yeah, so the Audi had to do what the Audi had to do, and in fact it almost, I think, lost the place to the BMW that was following. So Andy Suchek, that was a hard move he put on the Audi, but he got track position and he made it stick. He didn't concede and he stayed on the track, whereas the Audi had to suddenly deviate to the left to continue without having made contact. Christopher Meese continues pushing the leader, gap down to 3.2 seconds. Yet again, another fastest race lap for the young driver in the Audi number 33, 1 minute 43.4.
John, as you know, I race work quite a lot in America in sports car racing. I've never seen a track so full of cars. This is ridiculous.
Well, I'll tell you right now.
I mean, that's just the row racing BMW right in the middle, the Ferrari right behind it.
That's Robin Friend's. He started well back, and unusually, again, Robin Friend is somebody who you expect to see up at the front, so he made a good pass down into turn one, and that's a difficult place to make it stick to the 99, Philippe Eng, BMW. So Robin Friend's just trying to do the thing that everybody's been doing, that's play catch-up.
That Eng car is the new one, of course. It's replaced the one that's gone into the museum, which won the Spa 24-hour. Terrific result for BMW, winning that big long-distance race for the second year running, not with the same model. And
just looking down the timing and scoring, we know that car 58 was required to give a position back. Now, we don't know whether that was with the lead, so the other guard car, the sister car, the 59 car, or whether it was with the first of the Pro-Ams, the 87, which are in the ACA ASP Mercedes-Benz. So at the minute, the Alvaro Parent is directly ahead of Colm Lettergaard in 59 McLaren.
Fans out there enjoying the sunshine, enjoying this fierce racing battle here for points tonight. And then, of course, we'll be back tomorrow with the main race. But Rosenqvist just holding that lead. It's tightened up a little bit, but he's still got over 3 seconds over Christopher Meese. Of course, the pit stops have to be carried out so quickly.
So this is the rear view from the 99 BMW. And there we see Philippe Eng. Well, he's not seeing this. If he looks at his memory, he will see the nose, the red nose of a Ferrari, but he'd probably be focusing much further down the road and trying to get the position with Robin Friend. He lost that a lap ago coming down here. He goes defensive down the inside to prevent the Ferrari, the 111 Ferrari, from trying to get through the Kessel racing car of Steve Earle and David Pearl. And that's a strong race from a car that is an AM car against a Pro car. And look, he's actually made the pass stick, but runs slightly deep into turn two and allows the BMW the chance to give it a hip and shoulder as they come through the exit of turn two, takes the position back. Good racing for both drivers. I mean, there may have been very little but gap between the two cars, but they didn't have contact and therefore. But the Ferrari had good speed in the straight to be able to put itself into that position.
Certainly did. And, Eng knows his way around here so well. He's done a lot of Porsche Super Cup races because he's the reigning Super Cup champion. So he knows his way because those races sit alongside the Formula One events. And, of course, this Hungarian Grand Prix venue, as we said, resurfaced this year. Not nearly so bumpy. Different sort of curbing. I don't know how much it really helps, John, when you're this far into a race weekend, if you're new to a track. I think there's still some little nuances that you don't know. You only pick up over a period of time. Still that damage on the 19.
Yeah, I mean, the thing the driver's going to go into is this territory of, well, they've never done as many consecutive laps on a single set of tyres. So we don't know that. The teams that came here and tested weeks ago will have done all this homework, but they wouldn't have been able to maybe consolidate it here once this race weekend got away. But you can see already some of the Nicky Katzberg getting ready in the row racing BMW team. Steph Dusseldorf likewise in the row racing team. They're getting ready because this pit lane's going to be opening up in another 4 minutes or so. So are they going to see the two BMWs making early stops? Or, as I would imagine, both BMW drivers are doing what you would do, and that is be prepared for the unexpected.
Yeah. Rosenqvist mainly just put down a very quick lap, John, again. He's certainly keeping that gap at 3.3 seconds. He had a fastest sector three time.
So 87, now why is that coming in? That's a problem, clearly. It's not, obviously, it's outside the pit stop window.
Yeah. So the 87 car, the AKA ASP car.
We've got a yellow flag at sector three. That's assuming that's for that slow car coming in, but whether it was that or something else. But actually, Andrew, the pace that we've seen at the front from these lead three cars has been really outstanding. They've been within a second, just under a second of the pole position time. So there's the Mercedes
up on the jacks.
And it's going into the garage.
Yeah, the dollies are under. That's the end of that.
So there's a problem for that 87 car. We don't know what that might be, but clearly it's more than they can attend to on the pit lane, of course, by pushing the car into the garage. It allows more than the mandatory two only per car in the pit lane.
Absolutely, but in a sprint race of this huge standard, that you're not going to finish anyway.
I mean, no, that's effectively over for that Mercedes, so it's a disappointment. As we go back to this battle going on behind the lead Mercedes, it's 3.4 seconds now between the Mercedes and the lead Audi of Christopher Mies. Laurens van Thor has faded a little bit, actually.
A little bit, yeah.
He's dropped from just 1.1 seconds to 2.6 seconds, and that's going to bring him closer to the Mercedes of Dominic Baumann in fourth place. Now, Baumann is currently 4 seconds, but Baumann will be aware that the gap has marginally closed as we look and see what's going on with the Mercedes. So the front wheel comes off. Now, whether this is a brake problem, I know that the Nissan team had a brake problem, which was called, it's a thing we would call on the trade, knockoff, where whether it's running over curbs or something, when you put your foot in the brake pedal and the pads and the disc are not functioning as one, you get a big long pedal. It's very disconcerting. So the Nissan drivers have been having to pump up the brake pedal to get brake pressure on the straight bits before they would apply the brakes going into turn one or turn four or other parts of the track.
Great shot of our lead car here, the 88, so no problems with that from the same team, of course. And just listen to that burbling engine there. It sounds great, doesn't it? So Rosenqvist keeping that gap, 3.4 seconds at the moment. And John, just think about the number 86 car in fifth place with young Jules
Simkoviak.
Yes, that's a bit of a tongue twister. He's going to hand that car over to the multi-DTM champion, Bernd Schneider. Not his first flush of use, but he's still quick.
Yes.
Well, do you think that will move it up? Or is gonna, they're pretty well matched these days, those two.
I think Simkoviak has got out-and-out speed. I think what Bernd Schneider has is also out-and-out speed. But he's got his race head that's done so many events of all descriptions, either touring cars, GT cars, single-seaters or whatever. And he brings just a sense of maturity and stability to that particular car. So Simkoviak in fifth place is, 13 seconds behind the lead Mercedes. And it'll all come down to the pit stops. Can the AKA ASA Mercedes do a stronger pit stop as the 86 Mercedes is going to do? So that's a big question. So HTP, we know we'll do a good job. AKA ASP are going to have to match that or even better.
It's a younger team, really, yes. But Mies in second place. He's just done a fastest sector three. So Mies is not giving this up. The battle between those two is now 3.4 seconds. It's another just under 3 seconds back to Van Thor.
So the pit stop window is going to open up. And, well, you can see the clock ticking down. It'll be 15 seconds, as I said. So the earliest opportunity, it does look as if the BMW might be in as one of the Lamborghinis. The 100 car has been in and driven through. We don't know what that particular issue was, but that was still too early for the mandatory period, that 10-minute window.
Still right over those curbs. Some people taking a real shortcut there, John.
I think. Well, you can see the Bentley, the hop, skip, and jumping over the curb coming through turn seven. A lot of drivers taking the curb on the inside isn't going to be viewed as maybe as severely as using the runoff on the outside. It's the outside of these corners, particularly turn 4 and turn 11, and to some degree here coming out of turn 14.
Meanwhile,
as we watch the lead Mercedes, just see how much, well, he does. In fact, he's very controlled.
And he's on a very quick lap again, John. I think this fastest lap of the race, I think.
Laurens van Thor is in, and look how wide he runs coming into the pit lane. Now, that's interesting that Audi have chosen to make one of their cars at the earliest opportunity. And we see, was it the 74 Audi as well, the ISR, second of their car, their 75 car, of course, got tagged in that contract. So that's Marlon Stockinger, and Frank Pereira will be getting into that. Nissan likewise. So a lot of teams taking the opportunity for that early pit stop. Number one, now watch and see how quick this pit stop, because this potentially could allow that number one Audi to leapfrog the 33 Audi, maybe even the number 88 Mercedes.
It's going to be a very crowded pit road indeed here. Pit stop's taking about 22, 23 seconds, John, something like that.
It's a little longer than that, but just the driver change should be quicker than the wheel change.
Yeah.
So you've got four wheels, but it's only two engineers per car at any time, so only two people are allowed to work on it. So they do the left-hand side first of all, then run around and do the right-hand side first, then the left-hand side, and within that period, it should be possible for a driver to make it. Now, a lot of the cars are left-hand drive, so when they do the driver change, they want to make sure the driver change is complete before the engineers get round to the left-hand side. And look at the scrum coming out of the pit lane. And the Audi had Bendy did a good job, Zach Bendy, but have made up ground as they come down the pit lane. We have to wait and see until this all plays through as to see where the number one Audi will be. The lead car, the second place car, yet to make their pit stop. And yet another fast lap on the last lap from the race leader. This car did a 1:43.3. That's bringing it within almost half a second of what was pole time set in much cooler conditions when the tyres were a lot fresher. That indicates actually what's happening is the racetrack now is beginning to come to the cars, maybe more so than it did at any point over the weekend.
Certainly seems to be the case. See the number four car as we get a very quick lap from Mies. But the number four car, the team manager, has to report to the race director. And I wonder what that could be. That's the Dries Van Thor and Robin Fringe car. So obviously it's in Fringe something or other. Could be a penalty for that one. But we still got to see how this, how far this 88 goes before it makes its pit stop. Not quite so crowded now. The Czech team there with the Audi, there in the pits.
So you're just literally the driver. The teams and drivers practice this every day when they're here. But always when you get out in the real situation, something catches you. It was the 85. We saw the 85 car start from the pit lane. So that's I'm just looking to see where 85, in fact, is in the order we're looking to start. Well, in fact, Jasmine Jafar got that car up to 19. That's a good effort. We didn't see a lot of that in the opening lap. So he's made good progress in spite of starting in the pit lane. Mind you, the safety car, or the full course yellow, I should call it, gave something back to Jasmine Jafar, but he's done a good job to get through the cars that he would have been naturally behind.
It certainly has, but the first two cars still out there. They have got 14 laps in the book, and they haven't stopped yet. But look at Mies, he's on fire at the moment. He's just taken another 0.4 of a second off Rosenqvist in the Mercedes.
So a very strong run right now from Christopher Mies, as we've seen a great drive all the way through. And on the 15th lap.
R8's wheel nut to wheel nut. Look at this, John. Oh!
Well, a big lockup. I thought maybe at one point there was bodywork. I think there might be bodywork rubbing on that 74 Audi because it did it as it came through the exit of turn two as well. So that wouldn't be a wheel lockup. That's just, I think, watch see coming into turn four. It is snagging. It's a bodywork snagging somehow. There must be a little bit of contact somewhere in that 74 Audi around the front splitter spoiler, and that's causing the tyre to rub against it.
Could that puncture the tyre, or is it not an issue, really?
It depends just how much the rub is. If it's only very light, which is what I suspect it is, it'll effectively self-cure. But nonetheless, you never want to see it because it means something's rubbing against the tyre. You can see that the fact that the front of the car has been slightly rearranged, and that's why it's rubbing. But inevitably, the further you go, the less it's going to rub.
And actually, it's a titanic battle between those two, 74 and the three there.
There's Frank Pereira behind the wheel of the 74. And, I mean, look at these other Audis all over them, down, up the inside into turn 12, and in fact, Frank Pereira gets completely
swamped, he was.
Yeah, he just got sort of overpowered. Now, whether he's going to come into the pits, I don't know. But the three, looking at the three, to see who's in the three at the minute, it's Rodrigo Baptista and the 20...
Is that 28? Is that the Renny Rast?
That's the Renny Rast car. So if Renny Rast is behind the wheel, we're not quite sure that was a pit stop for that car.
I believe he is.
So that'll be progress from Renny Rast. There is our race leader. The gap down to 2.4 seconds. Where's that gone? All of a sudden, Christopher Mies has done a blinding job, and he's into the pit. So Felix Rosenqvist, who's led from the lights going out up until the completion of lap 16, he's in the pit lane.
Christian Vautier will take that car. Young man that made most of his racing career in America, although he's from France, done some IndyCar races and also raced for the Mazda long distance team over the States, and now really settled in, and a very good partnership with Felix Rosenqvist. We'll see little Felix jump out, reigning European Formula 3 champion, Macau Grand Prix winner. And that's how they practice that, I can tell you.
One of the advantages that these two drivers in particular, is that they are, let's say, of the shorter variety. They're about 5'6", 5'7". They're not some of these very tall, like Steph Dusseldorf, who's over 6 feet.
Frank Stippler, how tall is he? He must be about 6'4".
Frank Stippler is one of the taller drivers, so the shorter drivers have got an advantage. There is the number one car, and we have to wait and see, is this Mercedes-Benz, which has led from the lights going out, will it regain? There's the car that's going to challenge it, the number one, and that's now got... Watch and see, it's going to be really, really close.
Well, it's out in the 33 we're watching, isn't it? The Mies car.
Frederic Ravish comes down the pit lane, but the Mercedes has got it, but the gap is now going to be between the number one Audi in second place chasing because we have yet to see Christopher Mies make his pit stop.
Yep.
Vincent Voss, well, he's done a good job with his team to get that car in, and they've effectively shortcut the lead between what was the third place Audi, which was driven by Lawrence Van Thor, and the lead Mercedes driven by Rosenquist.
But the key now is going to be the pit stop of the 33.
The 33 has a chance, I believe, to take the lead of this race. And of course, he's got to come in probably on this lap because we're coming close to the closing of the pit stop window. So will he come in now? It's going to be a 1 minute. He is coming in.
Yeah, he is.
He had to because he couldn't have done it in the time available. So at the last minute, Christopher Mies has driven the 33 Audi in. This is the pit stop that will either win or lose, I think, this race for that, the 33 Audi of Christopher Mies. And we're there to see.
I'm going to try and get a stopwatch on it, John.
But the thing is, it's Enzo Eid who's taking over. And with respect, Enzo Eid, a fine amateur driver. But what Christopher Mies has been doing in a recent races, outstanding. He's been well supported by Enzo Eid, but again, Enzo's been put under the spotlight. He needs to put in stunning laps. The pit stop will see it done. But look, there's the lead Mercedes. That number 33 is just caught. They've got the wheels changed, the jack's done, the car's rolling. Come on, Enzo, get it out.
20 seconds, that pit stop.
But it's the in and the out, the total time.
Yeah, it's
there's the Mercedes. The Audi is already rolling down the pit lane. This is going to be close. I think Enzo Eid has got a chance to get ahead or side by side as they come out. There's the Audi. They can't see the Mercedes yet. There's it coming now. So it's now there's your race leader. There's your race leader, 33 Audi. But remember,
he's not up to speed, though, is he?
No, but Vautier is up to speed. He's had that one lap out to get up to speed to get a feel. So for Enzo Eid, it's all new territory. He's going to be under pressure. The Mercedes, you can see just how quickly he's running down the Audi simply because he's got that extra lap of experience of the track behind him.
Got very few cars now which haven't made their pit stop. But the 86 car hasn't yet. The Mercedes was running in fifth, goes now up to second. And also the 63 Lamborghini.
So Bortolotti and Simkowiak are about the last two not to make the pit stop. On the pit stop window, we've got 54 seconds before it will be closed, and we can't tell quite where they are on the track right now. But Enzo Eid, he knows what the pressure he's got, but he's not only got, we're watching in effect. So the 86 is into the pit lane with plenty of time to go. We wait to see where is the 63, the Lamborghini of Mirko Bortolotti, because he's got 33 seconds to get into the pit lane, otherwise it's a penalty. So it'll be Bernd Schneider taking over the number 86 car, and as Bortolotti, he will bring that 63 Lamborghini in, and he'll be handing that car. It'll be over to Nicholas Poehler.
Yeah, Nicholas Poehler, see what he can do, but out on the track, I think Enzo Eid is going to be under a lot of pressure very, very soon. So, 20-second pit stop, though, it was. John stopped.
That car, 84. Now we've got Maximilian Book behind the wheel.
Yeah.
Had set fastest sector time a few moments ago on sector one. So, Maximilian Book in 12th place. So, in effect, it is the leaders by the 33. We've got Christopher Mead, it's not. It's Enzo Eid.
You see then, though, the Mercedes is right up the exhaust pipes of the Audi.
Yeah, indeed it will be. And that's the difference between a professional driver and... Remember, Enzo Eid is not a professional driver. He drives very, very well, but he is not at the level of the guys like Christian Vautier or Felix Rosenquist.
And he's not a playboy, he works in his family engineering business, so he'll be behind an office desk probably on Tuesday morning.
So the Lamborghini comes out. That was the car driven by Mirko Bortolotti, and it's now Nicholas Poehler. He was a little bit lazy. He clipped the pit lane exit line, and whether he got a wheel over it or not, those are the things that are constantly being observed by the race stewards to see was there any transgression of the regulations. It's lazy to do that because you don't need to run the risk. You don't need to take the chance.
Here is the battle then. There is the second place car pushing hard. Has it gone by him?
No, it's not. He's still behind it. So it's the lead is still Enzo Eid. We're still being shown Christopher Mies, but it's Enzo Eid behind the wheel. So he's being charged by the Mercedes. And then behind that, you've got Frederik Vervies in the number one Audi. Then Maximilian Book is in fourth place in effect. And then you've got Mike Parisi and Frank Stippler in seventh and eighth place. So we're just waiting now for the thing to cycle through. once the pit stops for the final two cars, the 86 Mercedes and the 63. Here we're going to see the lead car come across the line, and we will get it in timing and scoring. We'll be watching to see what the gap is between the 33 Audi comes across the line, the 88 Mercedes, 8 tenths of a second,
yeah,
and Frederik Vervisch a further 4 tenths behind the Mercedes.
Yeah, so that's really concentrating it up now. So a terrific battle as this race heads towards the checkered flag, John, and we're almost two-thirds of the way through. And, well, it's anybody's to play for on that top three. And the 84 Mercedes is only another sort of 6 seconds down the road.
Yeah, I mean, but that's the car with Maximilian Buch.
Yeah.
One started by Dominic Baumann. Maximilian Buch, again, I mean, a fighter of the first order, and he just loves a battle. It's going to be difficult to take 6 seconds out of Frederik Vervisch because their lap times, I mean, they're all running in very similar lap times, but actually the fastest lap of the race has gone to, in that last lap, to Frederik Vervisch. First driver in the race to break into the 1 minute 42. I mean, that's a stunning lap in race condition. So he's brought that number one Audi right up to the gearbox, the tail of the 88 Mercedes-Benz. And the pace of that number one, and you're looking into the Audi garage,
yeah.
You know, they know what they've got, but what they've got is how do we then translate it into leapfrogging ahead of the Mercedes in second place. But Vervisch has got natural pace, and yeah, he's got the Audi working sweetly.
What about the British challenge for the Bentleys and the McLarens? There's Felix.
Well, you've got that little sort of ankle snapper, Stephen Kane,
yeah,
in the number seven Bentley. He's down in 11th place. The number eight Bentley down in 16th place, Maxime Soule. Bentley managed to keep two sets of new tyres from qualification, so they felt that that was going to play, yeah, to their advantage. So look and see, 16th place right now with 21 minutes to go. Could be maybe slip into the top 10. But there's only points here for the top, you know, it's 8 points for the top six.
It's also closer to Rob Bell, who was the winner at the Nürburgring, down in 17th in that McLaren.
Well, there's not going to be much happiness for Garage 59 right now. They knew that they had a battle, and the battle was really trying to drag performance where they knew that they had nothing left in the tank. Just the way the BOP swings,
yeah,
sometimes it works in your favour, sometimes you feel it works against you.
Yeah, balance of performance.
Balance of performance, and it's a wonderful mechanism, and it's quite a sophisticated one, which is why we get multiple winners. We don't want one manufacturer or one driver pairing constantly winning. There's the 58 car, comes across the line, Nicky Katzberg directly behind, the Soule number 8 Bentley directly ahead of the McLaren, and then looking Alexander, yeah, Sim in the 99. I mean, what a contrast to what he enjoyed a month ago in Spa-Francorchamps.
Yeah, it's the highs and lows of motor racing. It's always been there. Ide doing a good job, though, John, in 1.4 seconds.
Yeah, and he's actually pulling away from Tristan Vautier. So that last lap from Enzo Ide was 43.7, as against Tristan Vautier, who did a 44.2. And, in fact, Vautier has sort of backed up Frederik Vervisch in the meantime. So whatever happened to Vautier on that last lap, we didn't quite catch. May have been a little error, maybe something with some of the back markers just coming into play. But Enzo Ide took advantage of it, and he's got a 1.3 second break. And you know, it's lovely just to have that when you look in your mirror, and what was a big red Mercedes filling it becomes a slightly large red Mercedes just drifting, yeah, back into the background.
Just looking further down the field, very good lap from Ordóñez, actually. We're not used to seeing this season in the sprint series, to see him in the endurance version. He just did a 44.9, which is much faster than the cars around him.
I mean, it's such a competitive field. Wherever you look, on a circuit such as the Hungaroring, there's really no part that any one driver car pairing is going to be able to beat absolutely dominant, as you might have done, say, for example, at Spa-Francorchamps, or even at Silverstone, where you've got those very, very high-speed corners and a long circuit.
Absolutely.
So this is a tight circuit. I mean, it's 4.4 kilometres. It's not a short
it's
circuit.
It's not short, no.
But it's everything is sort of corner upon corner, and they tend to flow into... Now, there's the battle for second place.
Yeah.
And Frederik Vervisch right now, and he's thinking, I fancy a bit of that second place into turn 12. And that was a bit lumpy for Enzo Ide.
Really smacked it over the curbs there.
Yeah, coming out was into turn 5, and he was a bit just clumsy in the braking and just overran it. So, but this is the number one Audi.
And when you do that, John, smack it over the curbs with that velocity and that force, it doesn't do the car much good. And then later on something breaks and they wonder why.
Well, it's not so much a matter of it breaking, but it does, it's unsettling to the car, and you can maybe pick up a little bit of something that's offline on the tyres. That will then have a bearing on the potential of the car lap time-wise. So let's have a look and see. So he comes, this is through, and I think he was just too far over to the left coming into turn five, and he leaped over Vance and Voss, and he's just counting the cost of that little manoeuvre. But the boss of the WRT team.
I don't know if you noticed, the sparks came out of the back of the car.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Obviously something hitting the metalwork. And very quick lap from Bernd Schneider, though, John. He just did a 43.8. Anything under the 44, so, you know, he's really pounding it round here.
Yeah, but he's got his eyes on the sister car, the team car of Maximilian Buch, who's 4.2 seconds down the road.
Yeah.
So he will be looking, want to try and get up to my teammate. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's more about what you will earn track position for the start of the championship race on Sunday. There are points 8, 6, 4, 3, 2, 1. They're not as important as 25, you know, 18 and onwards down you go. Nevertheless, it's getting, if you can get your car on the second row of the grid, that's what Bernd Schneider will be thinking about. He'll be a lot happier than starting in the third row of the grid. But again, Verbeek, you can see in the third of these three cars, he's pushing Christian Vautier all the way. The gap's now 0.7 of a second. And again, the gap between first and second, 1.3. So Enzo Eads sort of made a bit of a break.
He can
sort of relax in himself, and he won't feel quite so tense or so under pressure. The pressure's coming from Verbeek onto Tristan Vautier in the second place Mercedes.
And he's just a tad slower than Rosenqvist was, I think, for Tristan.
Yeah, a little battle going on for 17th place. Rob Bell and Steph Dusseldorf. And the BMW probably has got more straight line speed. We know that McLaren has been going through that whole scenario. Aggressive move coming through turn six. That was Steph Dusseldorf mooring the curbs, trying to find some way of getting past the McLaren. And he's going to have to be a little bit patient. He wants to force the issue around this part of the track. It's not ideal. Every corner, the lefts, the rights, they blend 7, 8, 9, 10. Then ultimately, the quickest of all those corners, turn 11. The lights flash. And look at this, defence to Vesta. That's going to come under the investigation. Rob Bell, that was a naughty move. And that may well get the attention of the race stewards. That was a... He did it once. He did it one way. That's the only saving point. But Steph Dusseldorf didn't concede. He put himself into that danger zone.
And
that'll come up on our timing and scoring as under observation. The stewards will make a judgment on it. They will decide whether to pay.
You thought he was just leaning on him too much.
I think that I don't like to see that kind of manoeuvre, particularly when you're coming into a corner. Dusseldorf had the speed. We know that he was a little bit quicker in a straight line. Again, I'm going to look down the inside, but he wasn't in position to do it here.
And he did a fantastic job of collecting it up, didn't he? Because the car was very sideways. We can see it now.
Yeah, I mean, Rob Bell's coming more and more and more and more. And in fact, he had the corner, but he couldn't slow it down.
But he made the pass, as it happens. Yes.
He made the pass, and then the McLaren makes the undercut.
Yeah.
So I think Steph Dusseldorf will be unhappy about that manoeuvre. Rob Bell, in fairness, once he found himself being monstered by the BMW, he got out of the way. But it obviously, Dusseldorf couldn't get it stopped. He'd got a lot of muck and dirt on his right front tyre. But look, the BMW, I can see entertainment in shed loads with these two battling. And they're battling all the way down. You know, this is for 17th place.
Just wonder if the vision's not quite so good out of that McLaren. Do you think he saw him?
Oh, no, he knew he was there.
All right.
There was no doubt. I mean, he knew he was there. He did. You're permitted to make one blocking manoeuvre. The point is that Steph Dusseldorf had the pace to continue the manoeuvre, to get up alongside, but in doing so, he had to put a wheel off into the dirt. Then Rob Bell pulled back to give him space.
Rob Bell, but look at the 88 is closing up now on Ead. 48 is now within 0.8 of a second, and a couple of very quick laps. It's taking time out of Ead, and now the battle is really on. Drive-through penalty for car 1-1-1.
That's Steve Earle and David Pearl. That's the AM Ferrari. You wouldn't have thought that two AMs would be done for track limits, but there we are. First car we've seen this weekend that's going to make a drive-through penalty. And remember, there's a battle in the AM Championship, which is no less fierce than what we've got in this Pro Cup right now. So 7/10 of a second now between lead Audi and second place Mercedes. So again, whether Enzo Eads has found that his tyres maybe not quite giving him the kind of grip front to rear, the balance of the car, something has changed. For two laps ago, it was 1.3 seconds. It's dropped by, what, 0.6, 0.7 of a second.
Do you think, because Ede is not a professional driver, he's maybe just taking a bit too much out of the tyres? Meanwhile, Tristan has just been conserving them a bit.
Well, I mean, the Vautier and the Mercedes have been pushing as hard as it can, and undoubtedly the 33 car with Enzo Ede has been doing the same. But you know, it just depends. The Audi might be working its rear tire, maybe that little bit more. The Mercedes, we know, is a very easy, or much, it is the easier of the two cars on its rear tire. So if Enzo Ede has got a problem, I suspect it's more at the rear of the car. He can't commit, he can't get on the throttle quite so early. And again, once we see what the gap is, it's remained static. So nothing gained on that last, almost identical lap times between first and second. So Enzo Ede has made that little compensation that a driver has to do from time to time to sort of reset the brain and focus on getting what you need to do.
12 minutes left, John. We did just see a red car coming in. That was actually the Steve Earle Ferrari taking its penalty.
So there is the lead. And Enzo Ede takes a very wide cut on the entry into turn two. And if I was Tristan Vautier, I'd be looking to get my Mercedes all the way tight on the inside of turn two to put myself in a very strong position that when I came out of turn three, up the hill into turn four, I might be able to put a bit of heat onto the back of the Audi. In the meantime, Maximilian Boek, 84, in fourth place, 2.9 seconds behind Frederic Ravish. Fastest first sector of everybody on the 26th lap. I mean, these guys, they don't know what's hot outside that their tyres are. They're just racing flat out.
It's going to be an absolutely grandstand finish with these four. Look at this. But, well, he's doing a great job for an amateur. As I said, he drives a Destiny in a week at his family engineering business. And fabulous job from him.
Well, the top three are covered by 1.5 seconds.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you can't really get a huge amount closer other than getting so close that you're going to stall out. So the gap between first and second, as we look at the 63 Lamborghini, which sort of at one point came into contention. In eighth place right now, in fairness, Nicholas Poehler. And then in ninth place, you've got the number five Audi, which is in fifth place. And that's Nikolai Müller-Masden. So that's a little battle going on for position as well. As we look, here's the lead. Look what's going on in the Mercedes, all over the back. Can he move down the inside?
Oh, switches sides. And
it's a bit of bodywork flicked up there. Yeah. And Ede runs wide. The Mercedes can get up the inside.
It's going to do it. No.
Oh, dear. That was aggressive. That was aggressive. There was contact, very, very light, a little bit of down the inside. Now, watch how wide Enzo Ede has been going. But, of course, this occasion, Vautier more or less follows him. And it's Frederic Ravish who's going to sit back and think, come on, guys, go on, keep doing what you're doing. I'm loving it because I'm going to pick up whatever's left of this race.
Ten minutes to go. And just noticed Rennie Rast all the way up to 11th place, John, from right near the back.
I mean, that's a stunning drive from one of the stars in the Audi driver lineup. And just, I mean, I can't say enough about Rennie Rast when it comes to racing, whether it's an LMP car or whether it's in a GT car. He is class act. But this is a pretty impressive battle. You know, the Mercedes, as they meet in the sandwich of the Audis. And right now, I don't know who's going to win this race. Anything could happen. Ravish has been taking lumps out of these two cars on the last lap. Lap 26, almost half a second. Previously 0.4, then just under a tenth of a second. Look at the emotion and tension in the garage.
Just interesting to see what the young Frenchman could do here to try and find a way round. Ede is doing such a great job as a relatively what we used to, almost what you might call a gentleman driver in a way, but he's far from that.
Well, I'll tell you what, I mean, he put a hard move on the Mercedes coming down the pit lane. There was very, very slight contact, a little flick of bodywork. I couldn't tell from whose car it came, but this time the gap doesn't need defending. You know, because the other thing is, there could be debris around it. I can't see. There's a bit of something yellow. I couldn't see what it was.
I think it wasn't from one of those cars because it flicked up. It's a different colour to what we see. As he looks down the inside again, and a bit of puff of smoke from the front wheel as it really gets harder into the ABS system there. So Ede hangs on with 8 minutes remaining. Well, this is going to be a sensational run to the finish. They're running pretty wide there. But Ede it is who hangs on. Half a second between Ede and Vautier. Babiš is right there in third place. And then the two more Mercedes-Benz. Then the 26 car is in sixth place. 26 car of the Santaloc team. That's Mike Parisi, who's doing a very good job too. It's mainly about Audi and Mercedes-Benz, so this is a big German battle here in this qualifying race as the sun starts to set here in Hungary. And he not making any mistakes. Absolutely great on the brakes, using the ABS to all its effect. And the three absolutely running nose to tail. Look at the gap there on our caption, 0.1 of a second. It's a bit like a piece of elastic, stretches out a bit. Concertina's back in again. And there's Felix watching on, and everyone's hearts in their mouths here. And now he pulls out a slipstream and has a think about it, but no chance at all going down into there. And the 88 car still trying to get by. Remember, he led the first half of the race with Felix Rosenqvist. 33 car, of course, driven the first part of the race by Christopher Mies. Mies doing a great job. Saw also him down in the garage there. Probably biting his fingernails. There's a couple of cars that need to be lapped here. This could make it very difficult indeed. And if anything, Vavish is closer than ever. Car staying nicely wide as this battle continues, and Burke's right in there as well. And then there's a bit of a gap then to 5 seconds back to Bert Schneider. Audi versus Mercedes-Benz, Titanic Deutschland motor manufacturer battle between these two marks. Just seeing it, Renny Rasto, he's still down in 11th place. Bit of a shout up two for the number two car, Michael Meadows and Stuart Leonard. Virtually unnoticed by John and I, doing a terrific job in 10th place. So the hunter and the hunted here. Except there's two hunters, really, if you count Frederik Vavish in the second of those Audis, the WRT team. They practice their pit stops twice a day, apparently. A bell rings, so they all go and practice pit stops, but that's not going to count now. It's all about pure pace on the racetrack here. And look at the 84 car, Bert trying to pull out, having a little look as well. And here's the a little further down the field, the Lamborghini, the Bentley number 7, which is running. That's the battle there for 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th place, I think. There's the Bentley number 7, Stephen Kane from Northern Ireland. Long single-seater career, helped during his career by Dario Franchitti for a while. And that's a good little struggle as well, but really this is about the battle at the front, 0.7 of a second. Four cars are now moved into this lead battle, and they're all within just 2.1 seconds of each other, with just under 5 minutes remaining, and any one of these could do it. What a titanic struggle it is here at the Hungaroring. This Blancpain GT series just producing such stunning racing. GT3 machinery at its very best, in a lot of space. What's happened there? The two car has stopped. And that's the Stuart Leonard. Well, a spin there for Leonard, and I just gave him a shout up. Leonard and Meadows and Stuart Leonard, the amateur driver, and spins it. Don't think he's lost too much time. But meanwhile, Eads just hanging on. Only 4 minutes, Enzo. I'm not sure if he is named after Enzo Ferrari, but he's still driving like a champion, that's for sure. And he comes past the pits again. Vautier, 0.7 of a second behind, and then it's a second back this time to Vavish. So the elastic has pulled a bit wider for a moment. Longer shadows here, you can see them in the cockpit of the car as we ride aboard the car in fourth place here. And hear the whine of the transmission, the roar of that German engine up front, although as John told us, it's pretty far back in that engine bay. And he hangs on under enormous pressure. This is going to be the drive of his life. He's going pretty wide there, though. The stewards might not like that. And car 28 has been given a black and white warning flag, and 59 and 19, all for disrespecting track limits. More sparks coming as they bounce it across those curbs, really curb it. 3 minutes to go. Ede hangs on from Vautier, the Frenchman, with IndyCar Racing, the Indy 500 indeed, in his CV. Vavish right there as well, but it's dropped a second back now. Book there, another 0.6 of a second. And you see McLaren down there, not really in the hunt this time, very different to the race at the Nürburgring. Swings and roundabouts in this championship. Ede hangs on though, doing an absolutely fabulous job for a non-full-time driver. There he is coming, climbing up the hill again. And flashes past our camera. And I think, can I just see his hand come out of the window? Is it getting really hot in there? Well, he needs both hands on the wheel for this final couple of laps here at the Hungaroring. Vautier is right there, but it's 0.8 of a second. In fact, it keeps changing all the time. Our timing screen can't keep up with the action here. It's so absolutely ferocious, vicious racing here. As Ede hangs on for what will be the greatest success of his career. I wonder if he can translate this into the main race tomorrow. We're going to have that, of course, live on your screens as well with John Watson and myself. John has already made his way down to greet the winner, and it's a bit of a run from here, but he'll be there to talk to the top runners. He's going to be finding out from Enzo Ede what he thinks about all this, and he's going to think, well, a huge amount, but who knows what can happen in these closing seconds of the race. Can he hang on? He hasn't made mistakes. We haven't seen him locking up brakes. We haven't seen him missing the apex. We've seen him driving a perfect race. And he hangs on here. Let's see how he turns into this one. And there his co-driver, hands clasped in front of his face. And there, Vautier's co-driver, two men, they can do nothing now. They did their part of this one-hour race. And the seconds quick down, and they we're on 40 seconds now. And I think this will then be the last lap. And still, Vautier's there, but he's not quite close enough, is he? And he, the grain, pounds it through the ABS system. And another Audi Mercedes-Benz right behind. It could third place change right at the last minute. Vavish under a huge pressure. And look at this, and Vavish just hangs on. We go on board to see it. He's looking to get down the inside. It's Maxi booked, and doesn't quite make it. And now the checkered flag must be waiting. The checkered flag is out, and Enzo Ede is going to score a famous victory, I think. But anything can happen. Still, of course, here in the final few corners, as they climb back up the side of the hill. This racetrack basically drapes itself down the side of a small hill, and there Ede still hangs on, just a little something hanging down below the car, but I think that's not going to be any problem at all. The front two have just broken away a little bit from the second two, and here they are, left and right through these final few corners, this battle for the victory here. The checkered flag must be waiting shortly now. The hour has run out, and there's Enzo Ede. He hangs on, he still hangs on. Continue to climb up the side of the hill. Still the pressure on from Vautier, though. But it's a car length, and that's not enough. I don't think there's anywhere where he can find a space through. And here he comes, round the final corner, and heading towards a famous victory. And the checkered flag, is it waiting there? And yes, it falls, and Enzo Ede wins there for Audi. Terrific race. So Enzo Ede in the 33 car, outstanding job. from Enzo Eden and Christopher Mies, of course, laid the foundations for that victory. And Christopher takes some congratulations. And look at this battle to the line. So, number one Audi is third, Mercedes 84, then Mercedes 86, and then Audi 26 and 7 across the finish line. And still there's a few little battles going on down the field, and Rennie Rast got it all the way up to 10th place. Well done to him. So, a bit breathless after all that. Enzo Eid, I think when he went out for the second half of the race, I think both John and I thought that he wouldn't be able to hang on and that Vautier would get by him again. Of course, he had a great pit stop. Let's not forget the fantastic pit stop for the boys from the Belgian Audi club, Team WRT. And we saw Vincent Vos down there, and they did a fabulous job to get that Audi out before the Mercedes-Benz. In a way, that race was won in the pits by that team. They are very much a part of that success of the Marshalls. They're their orange uniforms of contrasting styles. Wave the flags here. Had an excellent day's racing. There's been some good support races too, with lots of action. So the fans are going to go away very happy. And hopefully they'll be back again for more tomorrow. So everyone winding down a little bit now after that struggle. Race is quite early tomorrow, the main points-paying race. And we'll start, we'll be on the air about 11:30-ish, I should think. We'll bring you that sprint race in this championship. And those marshals, saw them doing that earlier in the day, actually. I'm calling it the Danube two-step. So everyone coming back into the Parc Fermé area. And the just a bit of housekeeping, the 111 car, which had been off track and incurred the wrath of the stewards, got 30 seconds added to his time. So he'll be right off the scoreboard, I should think, there. The winner of the Spa 24 Hours, Alexandra Sims, only in 21st place, and the 59. Martin Plowman, that is, McLaren, that finished well, a very disappointing 23rd. So, everyone, there he is, saluting Enzo Eid, what a great way to do it. Christopher, this great character, had a lovely chat with him at the Spa 24 in the middle of the night. And something of an unsung hero. Made his name basically at the Nürburgring, but can race anywhere. And I think Enzo's going to do some celebrating here. Well, just the fist. Enzo on the crash helmet. And, well, East and Eid, a great pairing there. And a little bit of dehydration down the back. Crash helmet, Karit with the hands design will come off. So Eid, Vautier, Vavish, Burt, Schneider, and Mike Parisi doing such an excellent job in sixth place. Frank Stippler, I should say, in seventh. But one of the drives of the race for me was Rennie Rast coming from way down. They had problems in qualifying. The 98 McLaren was 18th, but I think we can get down to the two winners of this race. So let's find out how excited they are.
Enzo, I've got to come to you first. I thought a brand sat you at a race of your life, but this has to be your greatest win. Just outstanding.
Really nice. The pit stop boys did a great job. Christopher was in P2 before the pit window. So I came out in front in P1 and I managed to stay there. I had the Merck a few laps quite close to me, put a lot of pressure, but...
And yeah, you put a really hard move on the 88 Mercedes coming into turn one.
Yeah, really, I cannot describe it. It was a tough stint for me.
Anyway, well done. Christopher, you started the car, you chased the 88 Mercedes. great pit stop by your team got you into the lead. But I mean, Enzo, I mean, I'm almost lost for words.
It's unbelievable. I mean, we have three wins. We're leading the championship. If someone would have told us that before, we would have said he's crazy. Enzo did a fantastic job keeping the lead. The boys did an awesome job. You know, the car 33 car crew is just amazing. Quickest pit stop once again. And yeah, now we are back in the championship lead. And thanks to WT and thanks to Enzo. Great, great day for us.
Well, I saw him out in the town last night. I suspect you'll both be out. Well, maybe not tonight, but tomorrow night.
Probably we have a good night tomorrow.
Well done.
Thanks, typical Watty down there with a riposte. And Enzo, a little red in the face there. I mean, he's not the slimmest of drivers, is he? Not sure how much time he spends in the gym. A lot of these race drivers spend a lot of time in the gym. So, well, we heard from the first two, but let's hear from Rosenqvist and Vautier with John Watson.
Felix, you had a great start. You led up until the pit stop, but just you got beaten in the pit stops.
Yeah, I think we had a quite perfect race apart from that. Somehow we lost, I think, around 5 seconds in the pit, and we have to analyze what happened. But anyways, you know, I think sometimes it happens, and it's just a qualifying race, so we are quite happy to be P2. It's our best result so far in the Blancpain Sprint Series, so I think we have to see it positive.
Now, you had a great start, but you had an even better start after the full course yellow. I mean, you just were they asleep behind you?
I think so, yeah.
Tristan, I mean, you had a battle with Enzo Eid, got really close into turn one near the end.
Yeah, I mean, congrats to them. They had a great race. A bit bittersweet for us, obviously, with the mega stint that Felix did. It's a bit bittersweet to lose it on the pit stop. But, you know, overall, as he said, it's our best result in the Blancpain Sprint. The car has been amazing all weekend. Just know it's the qualifying race only. And we focus on tomorrow. We see.
Well, you two guys, you've been in the class of the Mercedes field here this afternoon. On the front row of the grid tomorrow, Christian will start.
Yeah, I mean, we swap over tomorrow, see how that goes. I mean, the pressure is on him instead then, so it's quite nice for me, just jump in and go. No, but I think we just have to work on our pit stop and everything else seems really perfect. So, yeah, that's the target for tomorrow.
Great to see kids doing a good job. Well done, guys.
Thank you.
Well, kids, you know, John Watson's a bit old, of course, so he thinks that boys of 25 are kids. I think 17-year-olds are kids, but yeah, there we are. The second-place duo drove a great race, as we heard, just pipped in the pit stop. But John is there with everyone. He's found the third-place drivers. Let's hear from them right now.
Lawrence, you and Frederick couldn't have driven any more. You just drove the wheels off your Audi, but the grid position hamper you a bit?
No, I did the very best I could, but yeah, I'm a bit, I don't know the word for it, a lot of question marks in my head, because in Misano we were obviously very strong, and for some reason since then, after Misano, we never really had the pace and the feeling we want to, and we're struggling.
You mean you're getting something out of the car?
I don't know, I'm not going to blame or point finger at the car, or it can be me, I don't know, but Misano, we were very strong, we won, and since then it's gone and we cannot find the cement back, and it's a bit frustrating. We're trying every evening to find a solution and to improve, but it seems not work yet.
Well, anyway, listen, I'm going to talk to your teammate Fred. You had a grandstand seat for the battle for the lead of this race. I suspect you were waiting for them both to take each other off.
Yeah, that was the plan. I mean, for sure I would not attack too much. I would not risk too much because the big points are tomorrow. But like Laurent said, we had some good pace in the beginning, but then it's quite difficult here to overtake and to risk at all in this race is maybe a bit stupid. So we will see for tomorrow. But yeah, okay. At least we have a podium, so.
Yeah, but I mean, in fact, you did have the pace of the two lead cars, but just there was no chance to make an overtake.
No, it was really difficult. I mean, like Laurent said, we're struggling a little bit, and if you struggle, it's not so easy to make a determined pass without any risk. So at the end, third, I think is maximum we could do today, and then tomorrow we will try to win. We will try.
Well, I'll say to you, tomorrow's another day. Look out.
Yeah, but I've been saying that for a couple of weekends, so I hope tomorrow's finally another day.
Don't worry, it'll come, don't worry. Well done, guys.
Yeah, he seemed a little bit down, didn't he? They can't quite find the pace they had at the beginning of the season. Let's check the classification, and after the 33 laps, Eden Meester, as we heard, winning from Vautier and Rosenquist. Favish and Van Thor in third place. Then the Mercedes booked and Bauman in fifth place. Schneider and Samoyak. And then Parisi and Christian Haase did a good job. Stippel and Salacquada in seventh place. Then the best of the non-German cars, Pula and Bertolotti in the Lambo. Moller, Madsen and Piccarillo, new driver in the scene. Ninth, Rast and Stevens up to 10th. Tronis drive, Van Thor and Fringe. 11th and Leonard and Meadows, despite that spin, in 12th place. Then the Grasser Racing Team, 13th, Racina and Mapelli. Kane and Abril come home 14th in the Bentley. Baptista and Jimenez, Soule and Suchet in that Bentley. And then Bell and Parenti only 17th, Dusseldorf and Katzberg. In the BMW, Jaffar, Schmid, Ordonez, Bunkum and the Nissan, Sims and Eng, Stoltz and Beretta, Plowman and Lediger in the second McLaren. And then the two Dutchmen in 24th place, Moll and Van Splutteren. Going down the field, the second of the Nissans was 25th Sanchez and Sean Walkinshaw, Brzezinski and Piccini, Pereira and Stockinger, Bure and Belloc, who dropped back through the field, and then going through to Steve Earle, who had a penalty, and then the DNFs. So that's the full lineup there after this qualification race. So excellent racing, really tough battle at the front. Certainly enjoyed that. Hopefully have for more of that tomorrow. So the crowd will win their way home, but meanwhile, here we will get some nice trophies and the podium ceremonies here. So looking down, I see several track sweepers out on the circuit to clean it up for tomorrow morning. In fact, they're all Unimogs, as it happens. So there they are. In third place on the podium, and there they're coming through. And the two Audis and a Mercedes-Benz. The two Belgian drivers. The World Silver Cup winners are on the right there. Silver Cup. Muller Madsen, one of those Silver Cup winners. Piccarillo driving alongside him, and I believe his first sprint race drafted in here. But we wait for the ultimate winners. But the well done to those Silver Cup. It was such a frantic race at the front of the field. We didn't get to talk so much about the Silver Cup. There is Enzo Eads, got his specs back on. And Christopher Mies. And national anthems will play. A bit of conducting there by Enzo Eid, the Belgian national anthem for the WRT team. I think the trophies will come out in just a minute, and then I think we should probably have some bubbly spraying around. Well, the Silver Cup winners, okay, get their silver trophies, most appropriate. So good job for them. And the two V's get their trophies. Second place, little Felix Rosenquist, seen him race a lot in the European Formula 3 Championship. And great to see he's now making a career. I think he had about 5 seasons of that Formula 3 Championship, missed out on it 2 or 3 times. Finally got it and got the Macau Grand Prix victory. And as I said, also racing in America this year in the Indy Lights and doing a great job there. He's tested an Indy car. I think he's got a big career going for him. But here they are, the winners on the top of the podium. And Enzo Eid deserves to smile. Great job from him. So there we are, trophies in hand, and they're off for a bit of a debrief with the team now, thinking about tomorrow, because that is the bigger race. And I think we'll be posing for some photographs as well, and everything's collected up. And the girls know what's going to happen now, because the champagne is going to come. But outstanding race here at Hungaroring for me, John Watson, Andrew Marriott. It's goodbye for now. So on the podium there, Enzo Ead, I think he's got the champagne all round. Oh, he's taking his glasses off, maybe he has. Yes, very wise move. Clinking the bottles nicely. And well, Ead was really one of the heroes of the day, because as a non-full-time driver, I don't actually like the epithet of gentleman driver. He's a non-full-time, a non-professional racing driver. But very professional in his approach, it has to be said, doing a great job and taking so much pressure there from Tristan Vautier. And should see an AM podium, and obviously these separate battles going on. All the cars, of course, are the same, but are different driver categories. We've seen the silvers already up there, but we've got the AM and we've got the Pro-AM categories. And all this very important, really, towards the excitement of this series. There's some points, look. Bell still leading on 124, but Burke closed up on him, and Bauman on 92 now. Soule and Suchek with 83. Mies, of course, climbing up 79. Van Thor 78, and Eng with 78. So Bell hasn't had Parenti driving with him all season, so that's why there aren't two of those. Here we are. And up on the podium with the Cecil amateur drivers. Kessel Racing Ferrari driver there. And the thumbs up. And there's the podium there. Oh, this is the Pro-Am first before the AMs. And the Pro. Kessel Racing winning, and there they are in the heat of Ferrari. That's Michael Brozinowski and Giacomo Piccini winning the silver in their Ferrari 488, run by Kessel Racing. Congratulations to them. In second place, they'll get their trophy, was the Mercedes-Benz, the AKA car of Christophe Bourré and Jean-Philippe Belloc. 87 in third place, the second of the AKA ASP Mercedes, Jean-Luc Belbelic and Morgan Moulin-Trafford. And that's a bit of a mouthful, I have to say. There they are. So they'll treasure those trophies. Good job for the silvers. But as I said, such a battle going on at the front of the field. We didn't have much time to watch them. But there's the Ferrari drivers and Kessel Racing lifting their trophies high. Outstanding job. Seemed to be sponsored by a car parking firm as well. Kessel always do a good job across a number of different series. And now we're going to have the bubbly spraying. And those girls, they're departing very quickly indeed. They've done that before, I think. In fact, the boys didn't spray the bubbly, so the girls didn't need to run, really. And playing to the camera a little bit. And then we're going to see a few trophies left. We're going to have the AM. So I think we might have another Kessel Racing entry up here. Mainly Ferraris, but it's a big battle between Kessel Racing and AF Corsa in that. There, Pro-Am driver points. Look at that. Bosniewski, we just saw, and Pacini. And then Moulin Trafford and Rizzoli, Bonaccini, Bobolik, Pereira, and Hasid. Hasid getting those points, I think, from mainly from the Spa 24 hours, where he was running. So Bosniewski leads that handy lead, 199. And now the AM podium. Winner there, car number 55, the AF Corsa, Claudia Snedwich. And Reno Mastronardi in their Ferrari, older style, Ferrari 458, not like the 488. And that's the third place trio from Kessel Racing, the 111 car. He was in a lot of trouble, Stephen Earle, actually. We just saw him up there, just Stephen from California and David Perrell. They're the second place. Christian Hook there amongst them, and Steve Parrow, and they're the winners come up now for AF Corsa, a racing team which runs over 100 cars out of its operation in Italy, and they get a lot of trophies. Italian national anthem for the winning entrant, and all Ferrari line up. The winners in the AM category finished in 29th place overall. And they will get their spoils of victory, some nice trophies, and Mr. Major, of the Vice President of the Hungarian Automobile Federation, hands that trophy over. I have to say the organisers here done a terrific job, circuit in great condition after this resurfacing. I'm sure Hungary would just so love to have some more drivers up near the front of International Series. Unlike a lot of the other countries in the middle of Europe, like the Czech Republic, not so many. There is the driver points. Lemeray, the Belgian driver, Belgian journalist, still in the lead of that championship, although he wasn't competing here, but he had a very good run at Spa 24. And also Talbot, the Australian driver, did very well. Liam Talbot not racing here this weekend. He's sticking with the endurance races. So, there we are. Final bottles of bubbly are sprayed. And let's check out some highlights of the race coming up. A race held in, hot and humid conditions. And, it all started, of course, with the rolling start. Let's see what happened. There they are. Underway there, and it was the red Mercedes of Felix Rosenquist who went into an immediate lead. The Audis cramming in behind him, people going out wide, and the 25 Audi turned around right in front of our onboard camera. We had then, while that car was rescued from its spot, we had a brief period of full course yellow. And then the action continued. And a great battle ensued. But the Mercedes continued to lead. Pit stops are absolutely vital. And in fact, it changed the whole course of the race because the WRT team, so famous for their pit stops, managed to jump. Here's the 88 Mercedes. And there, little Felix Rosenquist climbs out. There's a Vincent Voss from the WR team, who's been a mastermind of these great pit stops. And what happened, of course, was the Audi came out in front of the Mercedes-Benz. Tristan Vautier then tried everything he could. And now we had the driver, Enzo E, not a full-time professional, in the car. We thought it might gobbled up. He bounced it over to the curb. We had this moment when Rob Bell squeezed Sepp Dusseldorp. But got away with it, Dusseldorp reacting very quickly. There's bits of bodywork flying around, and still the pressure was on. all the way to the finish, and Fortier trying very hard. That was the moment he got the closest, but still he soaked up the pressure, did an absolutely terrific job on board there. And meanwhile, the second Belgian Audi was in third place. But it's been a terrific race here from John Watson and myself, Andrew Marriott. It's goodbye until tomorrow. Great racing.